you know, this talk is about improving iVersion. iVersion is the thing we have in the inode struct that you know, kind of tracks changes. So the motivation for this is NFS, obviously. So V3 relies heavily on watching timestamps, and timestamp Linux uses coarse grain timestamps when it like updates the C time or the M time or A time, and those timestamps are around one jiffy of granularity. And of course, lots of things can happen in one jiffy, and that can lead to problems in the client, you know, thinking that it has an up-to-date cache when it really doesn't. So for V4, what they came up with was this idea of a change attribute. So it's just an unsigned 64-bit value, and that has to change anytime the C time would be updated. It was originally considered to be sort of an opaque value, or at least clients should treat it as an opaque value. But there are some advantages to providing a value that that increases monotonically. In particular, the client can know that certain updates, that it, if it sees an older or a smaller iVersion than what it has, it can know to throw that out and that it's not valid anymore. Ooh, wrong way. So NFS v4.2 also gave us a way for the server to report what type of change attribute it has, so the client can make a decision about how it should treat it. In particular, the time metadata is particularly useful. Right now, we pretty much always report it as undefined. What we'd like to do is be able to report it as monotonic, which is the zero one. All right, so when should it change, right? So it should change any time that the metadata change time should changes, so the C time. Some servers can ensure that the thing is, that the change to that attribute is atomic with the change itself, but we can't do that in Linux. So when should we change it? We can either do it before, we can bump the iVersion before or after we copy the data into the page cache on the buffered write, right? In particular, right now, Linux bumps it before the change is visible, and that's bad because someone can race in with a get adder, see the new C time value, or see the new iVersion value, and then do a read before you had a chance to copy anything to the page cache. And now all of a sudden, client has now associated this new iVersion value with an old state of the cache. And that's bad. So if we do it after the change comes visible, it's still a little racy, but at least the client should catch up pretty quickly and realize that it is that its cache is out of date. And so if we increment it before and after, that's also acceptable. So in the field, it's basically just a dedicated U64 instruct inode. We have two flavors, right? So if you were running like an NFS client or a CephFS client, really what we want to do there is just copy whatever the server sends us, right? We don't want to try to manage this thing ourselves. But for local file systems, we have a kernel managed value. So that's where the kernel is responsible that whenever it goes to update the timestamps, it also needs to bump this iVersion field. And we have some infrastructure in the generic VFS to handle this for a lot of stuff. And you can opt into that by just setting SBI version. We have this in ButterFS, EXT4, XFS, and TempFS so far. So the kernel managed one is the really interesting one. It's enabled in all those file systems I just mentioned. We also requested it recently for GFS2, but they haven't done work on that yet. So the original implementation of this was just a simple counter. But that turned out to be really costly for EXT4 and XFS. Because every time you increment the thing, you had to log it to disk. And so in 2018, we changed to a new scheme, where we use the lowest bit in the counter for a queried bit. So anytime you go and do a get adder against the inode for the iVersion, we set this flag, and then we know on the next time that we go to update the thing that we have to go and bump the counter. Otherwise, we can leave it alone, because if nobody has viewed it, we don't really care. There's no delta, so it's okay. And with this, we were able to recoup almost all the performance that we lost when we first implemented the counter. So right now, in fact, EXT4 originally had a uh, had a mount option for this, and we just recently deprecated it, so yay, because it can be on all the time now. But it has problems. In particular, I did some work a while back, and I started noticing that sometimes I was getting weird cache invalidations, and I found that XFS and EXT4 both were bumping it on ATIME updates, which was bad, right? You know, you don't want to invalidate your cache just because somebody did a read. So we fixed that in EXT4 recently, but XFS uses their iVersion counter for some other uses, and they don't want to make that change. So we don't have a solution for that just yet. The counter is also bumped currently before copying to the page cache. So like I mentioned about the, you know, client, that can cause the client to, if you can race in and get a invalid cache. And then we also have the potential for lost updates due to crashes. NFSD doesn't wait until we've logged the value to disk before it starts presenting it to clients. So you can hand out an iVersion value, crash, and then have it roll backward. And then even worse, you can do another write, and now the client has an iVersion value it thinks is associated with the current state of the file, but it really isn't. It's a duplicate iVersion that represents two states of that file, and that's bad. So what NFSD does is it tries to factor in the C time on the file to mitigate this, right? Because if it crashes and comes back up and you hit it, then presumably you have a different C time. You'd be able to use that to distinguish between the two states. But you know, then you could have potentially a clock rollback that could result, you know, after your crash, that could result in you seeing duplicate values. But there's only so much we can do. And the other problem we've got with this thing is it's really difficult to test, which is why it was broken for so long anyway, with as far as like ATIME updates go. We don't really have good test cases in XFS right now because there's no way to query it from userland. To find this value, you have to go through NFSD currently. So anyway, I talked about, when should we do this? So queries of the iVersion, we don't have any locking around it. We usually update it alongside the C time. So for directories, that's C times are usually updated after the operation. But for writes, we usually do it before. So here's some possible solutions. One of the things we could do is separate the iVersion update from the C time update. You know, still bump this. Do we really want to change when we bump the C time? I think there's possibility of introducing new races if we do that. So I'm a little leery of doing that, but bumping the C time or the iVersion after the operation would be fine as far as we're concerned. So one of the things we could do is just do an extra iVersion bump every time. So we bump it before we do the operation when we set the C time and do it again afterward. Most of the time that, because of the way this, you know, because we are using that flag-based, scheme to determine when we should do it, that second bump will probably be a no-op in almost all cases. The only case it wouldn't be is if someone raced in with a get adder in between. And none of this is actually needed for XFS since they serialize buffered reads versus writes. I thought EXT4 did, but Jan pointed me out that I'm wrong. So ButterFS, EXT4, and TempFS probably need this extra bump afterward. Crash resilience, that's a problem. We have some potential. One of the things that was bandied about on the list as we were discussing this a few months ago was we could factor in a crash counter, stick it in. Oops, would probably have to be tracked by userland somehow. So it's an idea. One of the things we could, but the problem is we have to like estimate how many potential increments could we lose, right? You know, what's the maximum number of times we could bump this thing, the counter, beyond from when it was logged to, you know, what the last one we handed out. There's a way we could do this, but it's not trivial. This is some things I'm looking at. I haven't gotten very far with this one yet. So this is an idea here that Dave Chinner came up with, actually. He mentioned, as we were discussing a lot of this stuff, he said we should just use the C time. And he said, in fact, what we could do is just, use a similar scheme where we flag the C time when someone queries it, And then know that on the next CTime update, we're going to need to do a fine-grained timestamp. And this actually works pretty well. I have some draft patches for this that I've sent to the list a couple times. I do see some test failures with this currently. A lot of that is because some of our tests do things like get a coarse-grained timestamp, do an operation, get another coarse-grained timestamp, and then with these patches, sometimes that last coarse-grained timestamp looks like it is before your operation finished, right? And so that, that causes a test failure. And those are really problems in the tests. The tests are assuming that the file system uses coarse-grained timestamps, and with this we're breaking that assumption, so. But this is where I really wanna go. In the future, I wanna make this eventually queryable from userland, because I think that, having a infinitely granular change counter or change attribute is very useful for potentially for userland applications of all sorts. And in fact, what I'd really like to do is build a gated write. So I'd like to be able to do basically what you see in the pseudocode here, right? Be able to fetch the change attribute, do a read, modify it, and then try to write it back, but only if the I version hasn't changed. It's kind of like what Jan was saying, like we were doing with the read, where we would just repoll the thing every time. And the nice thing about this is, and I used a very similar scheme to this when I built some work and I did in Ceph a while back, and I really liked this because I didn't have to use any locking. If you're in a distributed situation, then you don't, you're trying to do locking is nasty. Yes, we could totally implement this with verify. Yes.
If you're doing this, perhaps you're better off if I version isn't incremented for things like Gmod.
I'm sorry, what?
Perhaps you're better off if I version isn't incremented for things like Gmod or...
Yeah. Unfortunately...
Or like UTimes.
Yeah, unfortunately, our semantics are kind of set, at least as far as NFS goes. So I think we would have a tough time. What you want is an AFS style change attribute, but we don't have that. So, you might get some false positives if this were to happen, but my feeling is that probably is not that bad.
What if we decouple this change cookie completely from iVersion, combine that with the crash counter idea that we had discussed earlier? In that case, the change cookie could just simply be an in-memory value. Well, I guess we have to worry a little bit about what happens if the inode gets pushed out due to pressure, memory pressure. But, in some ways, if we didn't actually have to write it out or could rely mostly on CTime, then, we avoid some of the extra overhead of having this extra thing that the file system has to track that has its own unique semantics about is metadata changes like Chmod included, yada, yada.
Well, I think that would be fine if all we wanted to do with it was this. The problem is that NFSD still wants to use the iVersion 2, and if you were to crash and come back, then all of a sudden we can't keep an ephemeral one for that reason, I think.
So. I think I might have already mentioned this on the list. The only thing that I find important is when we expose this cookie that it has clearly defined semantics.
Yes. Yeah,
and hopefully consistent semantics, because I always, when I see stuff like this, which kind of feels like it's not really clear what it indicates, I've always has F_FSID in mind in statfs, which is like nobody, literally on the man page, has nobody knows what it's supposed to mean.
Yeah. I mean, that's fair criticism, right? I've been trying to define this, and really, POSIX doesn't contain this, right? So this is a thing that AFS and NFS cooked up, right? I think we can do that. And kind of what the semantics we've come up with is that basically anytime you would change the CTime, you would need to increment this thing. And that is pretty well defined by POSIX. So I think that we actually know when, what it represents and when it needs to be incremented. But beyond that, yes, you're right. We do need to document it before we ever expose this thing. Absolutely.
One thing that might mitigate against double incrementing it is the way AFS does things. You do a write to the server and you get back a new I version, a new data version. It's going to be plus one. If it's the old version plus one, there's no interference with your right. If you double income it sometimes and not other times, you don't have that guarantee anymore. Yeah, but on the other hand, we don't have that guarantee with NFS anyway, really. Because it just, it changes.
Yeah. Yeah, and I don't think I can really, I don't think, you know, unfortunately, AFSs change attribute semantics and NFSs don't really mesh, you know. AFS has a change attribute too, but it's only bumped on content changes. So it doesn't care about metadata changes. Yeah, and you do it exactly once for every write, which we can't guarantee.
I don't have the exact discussion in mind anymore, so excuse me if I'm asking a stupid question, but how is, when a server crashes and an NFS server crashes and the crash happens, is it possible to detect this? Like, basically what happens, why isn't it possible to just to say, okay, I need to re-query iVersion after a crash?
Yeah, I mean, that's potentially something we could do. The danger, right, is that, let's say you have an iVersion of 2, right, and then you do a write, and you get an iVersion of 3, okay? Now you crash, and that iVersion of 3 never made it to disk. Server comes back up, so the client was aware of this, right? But someone else races in and does a write. Now we have another iVersion, you know, iVersion was 2 after it came back up. Someone else does a completely different write. Now we have an iVersion of 3 again. And
in between the crash, yeah, okay.
Yeah, so we can't, yeah, that's the that's the real danger, right? You know, the rolling back is not so bad. It's that you can roll forward again and get a duplicate value that represents a different state of the file. So that's the crash, the crash, you know, mitigating crashes is a really tough part of this, and I don't really have great solutions just yet. I'm open to suggestions for this.
Really, you need a server level last time I booted or last time I crashed thing that you can just say, oh, it went, wipe the cache.
Yeah, even then, I mean, it's not, yeah, I mean, you could just, but then that's nasty for performance, right? You know, if the, thanks, guys. So, yeah, the crash mitigation part is actually really tough to deal with, and I'm not sure. You know, we have some sort of hand wavy ideas. Jan had a good one. I mean, his was like, you know, that we should do this crash counter thing, which we could totally do, but we need to sit down and really work out the semantics.
I think AFS has something like that per volume. If the volume has to be recovered, it updates the timestamp on it.
Yeah, AFS
and
has
wipe everything. Well,
they don't have to deal with random file systems, right? Yeah. So.
Yeah, I think the other reason why AFS is a lot simpler is you don't have to worry about local writes.
Exactly.
That's the reason why you can guarantee it bumps by one when the users make a change. You don't have to worry about a local write interfering. The one thing I was going to note here is we already have a boot UUID that gets regenerated each time the system reboots.
Oh.
Okay. You know, we've actually had that for a long time because, you know, we had the UUID and generator, and it's in DevRandom. It's essentially each time the system boots, we generate a random, you know, 16-byte UUID. You can fetch it. It's like a global variable, never changes after you reboot. Now, it's not a counter. It's 16 bytes. You could hash it somehow. Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure how useful it would be in the context of fitting into the existing NFS protocol, right?
Okay.
But there is easy ways that you could, you know, have the NFS server tell, oh, yeah, you know, we've since rebooted, if you wanted to, you know, somehow use the previous version of the boot UUID and see that the boot UUID has since changed.
That's a good idea. Thanks, Ted. Yeah. I'll take a look at that. Anybody else have questions or comments?
Nope. I might be raining on your parade, but one comment I've been hearing multiple times in the room is, well, we're not sure what the semantics of this are, or the semantics of NFS's treatment of the attribute, it's not the same as AFS. And so I'm wondering if we might not be better off if each of these protocols handled this in their own way. The one thing you mentioned where you wanted this to be like exposed to user space, because the only way to test it was through NFSD. It seems like, you know, going over loopback or using PyNFS seems like a good way of testing that it does exactly what NFS needs. I'm just wondering if maybe we might want to rethink the idea that we want a common implementation for all file systems. Because the one thing is not mentioned here is that is the performance overhead is if everybody did this themselves versus it being done by the file systems. Could you talk a little bit to that?
I'm sorry, I didn't get
to put. So you're talking about having the file systems manage the iVersion or maybe the VFS? Well, what would the performance overhead be if NFSD did this for itself and AFS did it for itself? Because the semantics aren't the same.
I don't think we can really do that because, again, we have to deal with local writes, right? You know, NFSD doesn't know if someone has walked in and started doing writes to the file system, right?
So one thing that may help me understand context a little bit better is when I grep for iVersion, I see XFS, looks like it manipulates it. I think there were two other file systems, Ceph and ext4, the rest basically ignore it, but it looked like there were some libfs helper routines that mess with it. So it was not clear to me whether the VFS, looking at the code at first glance, whether the VFS bumps iVersion without you having to do anything, or whether this really is a flag that only three file systems can bump counters on.
Yeah, I mean, if you set SBI version in your file system in the inode, then the VFS will do that for you. So whenever it goes to update the C time, it will take care of the I version as well.
Because I looked at that and I didn't, well, I'll go look at it again, but I didn't think there were very many that set that.
There aren't.
Yeah. And, so. You know, I don't care. I mean, it seems like, you know, if it's low risk and it costs nothing, you know, turn it on. But what puzzled me is if really it's just three file systems that set it, then what if NFS is mounted on OverlayFS or I don't know what it picks?
Then it manufactures manufactures the change attribute from the C time in that case.
Okay.
So this is why I'm going to, you know, one of the reasons I'm going to this multi-grain timestamp idea. For instance, I'm going the wrong way. The XFS guys don't want to put a new field on their disk and in their on-disk inode. But if we can do this, then we can still manufacture a change attribute from the C time, and it's good enough with the fine grain timestamps.
I think having this be a helper, for example, and this being done in the VFS seems fine to me. I mean, three file systems, okay. Expectation, what's the right number for something to move up to the VFS? That's fine. Would the only thing that I pointed out I was trying to make, just to clarify with statics, change cookie being part of user space API, is that users have a difficult time making sense of a value that is exposed to them that has different meanings for very different things.
Exactly.
So, and that's the main problem. So when you suddenly have statics change cookie, I'm opening up the man page and I see for XFS, for NFS, and for AFS, and then I have to read through all of that and like, okay, this means three different things. That's the thing that I'm concerned about.
Yeah, I think in general, you know, all the local file systems that use the SBI version have the same semantics, right? NFS, and those semantics match what NFS uses. And the only real odd man out is AFS. And so I probably just won't wire up AFS to, if we ever were to present this to userland, right? I just probably wouldn't wire it up for AFS. Or we have some, we have the statx file attribute flags or whatever. We have one already so that the file system can claim that it's monotonic, or that its statx change cookie is monotonic. We could do one that said this is an AFS style, statx or an AFS style change cookie.
Monotonic, right. But not for metadata.
Right, you know, this one won't work for metadata changes, you know, and maybe userland can sort through that, so look at it and say, oh, I need metadata changes, I can't use this on.
So basically, the only thing we really want this for is for NFS data to export.
Right? Currently, right. But eventually, yeah. I would like to be able to use it.
Because if you're going to expose it to user space, what's the minimum promise we can use the space that she needs from it.
That it will be bumped anytime the seat time would change.
Is that the minimum? Well, yeah, but what would user space be using it for? Is it
to detect changes to the file.
Yeah, but could it be sufficient to say any time, M time changes and stuff the attributes? Because like someone does set
well, X, no, because
LSM does set X adder on it, it'll change, for example.
Yeah, if you put an X adder on it, the time the thing changes, right? No, I mean, you're arguing that we should adopt AFS's semantics. I'm saying that NFS wants this. We already have semantics in all the other file systems to do it a different way. So I would not I would be opposed to that idea. You know, just because it is, you know, AFS had it first, but their semantics don't match what we needed for NFS.
Yeah, because the other thing I would be using this for, from the AFS client's point, so the NFS client's point of view is tagging the local cache, which means if someone does chmod, bang goes your local cache.
But exactly, yeah. Which is unfortunate, right? Yeah. You know, that part is a bummer. But but those kind of changes are pretty rare.
Yeah, but actually, if you do these multi-grain timestamps, then user space could basically just use the C time to detect and doesn't have to bother with some obscure argument like obscure statics cookie.
Yeah, yeah. And in fact, you know, this is I'm liking this better because this
because
means it works for V3 too.
Yeah, it's also it's much easier to understand, like for the user space application, what it's actually getting.
Yeah, right? And in theory, you know, the most user space applications should be fine with the change in semantics here too, I think.
Yeah.
So I'm probably going to, I see myself probably implementing this kernel wide eventually. I'm probably going to do it piecemeal, you know, per file system to start. But I imagine most kernel file systems will want to adopt the scheme.
Yeah. So my point is that if we do this, that I don't see then such a need to implement the statics cookie change cookies.
Yeah, we may not need it after that. So.
Because then its utility would be really very limited.
Yeah.
And I totally agree with what you're saying. Is that you know in our case, fine grain for SMB is 100 nanoseconds. Is 100 nanoseconds good enough? But why wouldn't you use M time instead of C time if you're worried about the chmod example? Is M time good enough? Because everybody can explain to a user space what M time is and C time. Mm-hmm. But why isn't M time good enough for 99.9% of the cases?
It is. It's fine. It's just that when you 100 know.
100 nanoseconds good enough, by the way. I'm not 1 nanosecond. 100 nanoseconds I can give you. That's the best.
What I can do with the AFS version number is if I do a write and I get back new version number plus one, I know there's no interference. If I get, it was changed 100 milliseconds ago, 100 nanoseconds ago, I don't know there wasn't another change. That's normally been one of the problems with NFS, because you can't, the timestamps are not enough information.
So one other really quick thing, which is, you know, earlier in the slide you said that, you know, the kernel only uses second level granularity. That's true for the stat system call. Stat64 uses the time spec, and in fact, most of the major file systems are providing sub-second granularity anyway. It's not just XFS because, you know, make can compile an awful lot of files in 1 second. Oh, and the other thing is the reason why people like C time and not M time is you can fake M time using the U time system call and warp M time, whereas you can't warp C time.
The next session is actually in the BF cross. Talk about they're not on time. I mean, I can see on Zoom that they're not on time. I'll go check when the time, but you guys can just continue.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I mean, and I'm kind of thinking that, probably I'm going to move most of this stuff to using the multi-grain timestamp now, because that, you know, again, I'm just in early days on this, but I think that's probably where we want to go.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I have to fix a bunch of test cases, it seems like. So.
Yeah, so like for in-kernel, in NFS use, I can totally see you doing the I version thing, yeah, but
for user space, I believe the multi-grain C time should be enough.
Yeah, sounds good to me. So.